Good morning. It's great to have you with us today. We are blessed to have David Kosick as our soloist. I'll begin by doing a couple of announcements. First of all, I want to give all the youth a heads up. We're having a book share this Wednesday, August 19th, from 7 to 8 on Zoom. There's information in the leaflet or information on the website. Please check it out. We'd love to have you join us. If there's any questions, call the office and we'll give you the information. Secondly, we're having a book discussion. Our book is The Book of Joy, and we'd love to have you join us with this. It's this coming Saturday, August 22nd, from 10 to 11 on Zoom. And the invitation is found here or online. The Prayer Shawl Ministry has done an amazing job with prayer shawls. Many people have just been sitting home knitting these prayer shawls, and we have an overabundance. So please come and get one for that person in your life who might be suffering. We have some other Christian Ed opportunities in the leaflet, and I think that's everything. We're ready to begin. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and one mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire for you, with love, now and forever. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 537, Christ for the World We Sing. We'll sing verses 1 and 4.
The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him. For he cometh to judge the earth, and with righteousness to judge the world and the peoples with his truth. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 67. We will read the psalm together. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let your ways be known among the earth, and your saving help among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide all the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all peoples praise you. The earth has brought forth her increase. May God, our own God, give us his blessing. May God give us his blessing, and may all the ends of the earth stand in awe of him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right. For soon my salvation will come, and my deliverance be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath, and do not profane, and hold fast my covenant. These I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel. I will gather others to them, besides those already gathered. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles. Then the disciples approached him and said to him, do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said? And Jesus answered, every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit. But Peter said to him, explain this parable to us. And then he said, are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. And this is what defiles, for out of the heart comes evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, have mercy on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon. But he did not answer her at all. Jesus did not answer her. At all. His disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she keeps shouting after us. Jesus answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But she came and knelt before him, saying, Lord, help me. Jesus answered, it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. The woman said, yes, Lord, Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered her, Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish. And the woman's daughter was healed instantly. Holy wisdom, holy word. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This is not a comfortable gospel message. The encounter between Jesus and the Canaanite woman is very unsettling. It unsettles boundaries and calls into question definitions of clean and unclean. The first part describes the ongoing dispute between Jesus and the Pharisees over purity issues. Jesus makes the distinction between moral behavior and ritual practices. In the Jewish tradition, there are 613 commandments, many involving ritual practices that have nothing to do with moral behavior. Jesus maintains that evil intentions are what defile a person, and they come from the heart, not from unclean hands. For Jesus, this is a time of deliberate withdrawal. He knows the end to his ministry is coming, and he withdraws from the crowds for quite some time, for some quiet time. He still has a lot left to explain and teach the disciples, and there's little privacy for them in Palestine. Wherever they go, crowds of people greet them with all of their needs. They travel north of Galilee to where the Phoenicians live, into Gentile territory. But even at this distance, Jesus is not free from the demands of human need. His reputation has preceded him. Here we meet the Canaanite woman who has a daughter tormented by a demon. Now, I don't know about you, but when one of my kids or my grandchildren are in trouble, I'm a basket case. I don't care who I bother or bug or annoy. I want them to be okay, whatever it takes. And woe to the doctor on call. I can relate to this woman's passionate attempts to engage Jesus in conversation, to beg him for the help her daughter needs. She must have heard about Jesus and his miracles, and she follows him, crying desperately for help. Although she's a Gentile, this woman greets Jesus with the language of faith and worship, adapted for the Psalms. Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. Her recognition of Jesus as the Messiah is huge. Even Jesus' own disciples have been slow to recognize him as Messiah. This woman begs for Jesus' mercy and asks for his power over the demon that has possessed her daughter. Can you imagine this? This unclean outsider, both in gender and race, has more insight into Jesus' identity than his own disciples. There's something extraordinary about this woman. At first, Jesus gives her no attention, but he doesn't send her away. He has compassion for this woman, but she's a Gentile, a Canaanite, one of the ancestral enemies of the Jews. If his ministry is to have any effect, Jesus must put boundaries around those he serves. He cannot simply give and give and give. Jesus needs boundaries just like we need boundaries. He tries to target his Jewish audience, and yet, here is this Canaanite woman who will not stop asking for help, despite the fact that he's ignoring her. He explains to her that his mission is to the lost sheep of Israel, but that does not dissuade her. The disciples want him to just send her away. They're tired of hearing her cries for help. To them, this woman is a nuisance, and they want to be rid of her as soon as possible. Every little detail in a reading is critical to understanding the overall message of the story. Kneeling is a significant detail, an action that will be appropriate for a king, showing respect and recognition of power. We've seen this action when the Magi kneel before Jesus, and the unrepentant slave kneels before the king in the parable of the unforgiving servant. For the Canaanite woman to kneel before Jesus reinforces her earlier declaration that Jesus is the Son of David. Finally, Jesus turns to her and says, "It's not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the pet dogs." In effect, he's telling her that his time belongs to the children of Israel, and it's not right for him to waste his time on Gentiles. In biblical times, dogs did not have the advantage of Iams or science diet, and they were constantly scavenging for food. Dogs are an image of squalor and poverty, and to refer to another human as a dog would be an insult in the ancient world, insinuating that that person is among the lowest on the social hierarchy. Jews spoke with arrogance about the Gentile dogs. When the Canaanite woman accepts the priority of Jews over Gentiles, she responds in faith. "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Even dogs, as low as they are, get crumbs from the children's bread. Could I have just a crumb for my daughter? This woman refuses to be put off easily, nor will she take offense at what Jesus says to her. She matches wits with Jesus, and at the same time she maintains that in the abundance of God's blessings, there's still enough, even for the Gentiles. That is the key. Jesus has met his match. He acknowledges her faith and grants her request. Her deep faith is the deciding factor, one that transcends both her gender and race. She will not take no for an answer, and Jesus' final words express his approval. "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." Now there's four characteristics of this woman's behavior that we need to consider. First, this woman knows about love. It's out of the love she has for her daughter that she seeks out Jesus. It is love that gives her the strength to be persistent and allows her to seek the compassion of Jesus beyond what he says. Nothing is nearer to God than love, and we can see her faith grow in this personal encounter with Jesus. How often do we dismiss the love that the other has in their heart? This woman knows about love. The second characteristic is her faith. She begins by following Jesus and ends on her knees. Kneeling before him. She begins with a request and ends with a prayer. When you go to Jesus, do you remember adoration first and then petition? The third characteristic is her indomitable persistence. She is indiscouragable. When you pray, do you really believe that your prayer will make a difference, or do you pray because, well, something might happen? To this woman, Jesus is her hope. She comes with an urgent sense of need, a dedicated persistence, and a refusal to be discouraged, regardless of how little attention she receives. For her, prayer is an outpouring of her soul. Is it for you? The fourth characteristic is a sense of calmness. Here she is, in the midst of a storm with her mentally ill daughter, and yet she maintains a sense of calm. I have a quote that Sue Woodward gave me, and it says, "Life is not about waiting for storms to pass, It's about learning to dance in the ring. Life is not waiting for storms to pass. It's about learning to dance in the ring. This Canaanite woman is a rain dancer, the kind of person who always has a spark of hope in her eyes and knows that everything is going to be okay. The kind of person who tells you, now, don't you worry about this, everything is going to be okay. And this woman is not afraid to let that spark of hope light up the world. These characteristics, the woman's actions, finally lead Jesus to grant her request. She speaks to Jesus with boldness and humility, the only one in Matthew's gospel to win an argument with him and receive such high praise. Her great faith contrasts with the disciples who seem to have such little faith. As an outsider, the Canaanite woman understands what the Jews do not, that the good news belongs to everyone. Today we are reminded that through our actions, we also have the ability and the responsibility to share the crumbs with everyone. Who is the Canaanite woman in your life? And are you ready to share? Thanks be to God. Amen. We continue with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The suffrages. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. The collect of the day. Almighty God, you have given your only Son to be for us a sacrifice for sin, and also an example of godly life. Give us grace to receive thankfully the fruits of his redeeming work, and to follow daily in the blessed steps of his most holy love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit. One God, now and forever. Amen. The Collect for Sundays. O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor. through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A college for joy in God's creation. O Heavenly Father, who has filled the world with beauty, open our eyes to behold your gracious hand in all your works. That rejoicing in your whole creation, we may learn to serve you with gladness. For the sake of him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A collect for mission. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor. Today we are so blessed to have David Cossack sing our offertory solo. David is a graduate of Tatnall School and most recently, the University of Oklahoma. He will be leaving us in September to begin a new job in Wisconsin. He's becoming a cheesehead.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. That was beautiful. Please offer your own prayers silently or aloud. For parishioners to whom we are committed in prayer, Richard Booker, John Dash, Jim Finnegan, Dolores Haynes, Donnie Holweger, Peter Jenkoff, Ann Kirk, Dick Kirk, Shirley Lester, Ellie and George Lewis, Tori Robinson, Sarah Schwartz, Sue Scott, Jared Shea, Peggy Smith, Wilson and Joan Summers, Kathy Spencer, Fran Wilson, Sally Wolf. Today we also pray for Donna Allen, the sister of Mary Jo Tucker, who died on Tuesday. Please join me in the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you've made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all the ages. Amen. And now a prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Our closing hymn is number 470. There's wideness in God's mercy. We'll sing verses 1 and 3. God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you. remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Evermore. Thank you.